On this Memorial Day weekend, and maybe you're visiting with us, we're thankful for that. And we, if you're local, we hope that you get to come back and be with us. If you will, at this time, be standing for our Bible reading and our opening prayer. Among our guests is Clinton and Kathy Lane, and Clinton will have the prayer immediately after the scripture reading, and then you may be seated after the prayer. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land." Let's go to God in prayer. Amen. You may be seated. Our opening hymn is 189. All verses of 189. I'll be going that way.
I've heard of a land of joy and peace and wonderful light, a beautiful place of mansions fair and skies ever bright, where all who obey the Savior dear forever shall stay. And having been saved by grace divine, I'm going that way. I'm going that way. I'm going that way, and Jesus the Savior I adore is with me each day, yes, singing his praise
and ever still strain.
I'm singing his praises all. I'm going that way. The glorious news I tell and sing as onward I go, that those who are still astray in sin my Savior may know. I want them to sing his praise above some beautiful day. For glory to him who died for me, I'm going that way. I'm going that way. I'm going that way. And Jesus the Savior I adore is with me each day. I'm clinging to Him and never to stray. Yes, singing His praises all day long, I'm going that way. I know I shall meet Him at the gate when trials are past. I know I shall meet Him face to face in glory at last. And oh, I believe that when we meet, well done, He will say. For trusting His soul, redeeming love, I'm going that way. I'm going that way. I'm going that way. And Jesus the Savior I adore is with me each day. I'm clinging to Him and never to stray. Yes, singing His praises all day long, I'm going that way.
Our next hymn is our communion song. Some of you are visiting with us today, and if you're away from your home church and wish to partake of communion with us, you're welcome to. There were packets at the door that we use now instead of the communion being passed. So if you did not receive a packet and you wish to partake with us, raise your hand and we'll bring one to where you're seated at this time. Okay, it'll be brought to you. It's a coming right now. A fellow bishop here. Clinton used to be an elder here at the church, and one of the terms in the Bible for elder is bishop, so I call him bishop. And this is our new elder here, and we're so thankful for Marvin. Is there any others who need communion this brought to you this morning? If so, we'll be glad to bring it to your seat. We're going to sing Old Rugged Cross, and we'll do the first and last stanzas.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach which gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Good morning. I normally don't title a communion meditation. When I do, it's usually just for my personal records. But this one's called Comfort Food. A couple of weeks ago, after I got out of a doctor's office, Glenn and I stopped by at Bob Evans to eat. Against my better judgment, I ordered a country fried steak platter, one of the worst things in the world for your heart. Mashed potatoes, gravy, green beans. And about halfway through that meal, I said to her that this tastes like comfort food. Glenn asked, "What do you mean, comfort food?" So I asked her to look it up. And it is defined as simple, home-style food that brings comforting thoughts of home or your childhood. One of my most favorite memories of school was when I attended Chatteroy Grade School. Every morning when you got to school, the whole place smelled like fresh baked bread. And some of my best friends and my two brothers and I would go downstairs to the lunchroom. One of the cooks there would give us a big slice of warm bread with cow butter on it. Some of you youngins might have to ask what's cow butter to your parents. And it tasted just as good as it smelled. But another memory, it reminded me of this one, was when you drive through West Williamson. Back in the day when the Betsy Ross Bakery was baking bread. When you go through there, when I was a kid, I would roll the window down just to get a better smell of it. I mean, it just... the whole West Williamson part smelled like fresh baked bread. But think about that. Isn't there something that's comforting about fresh baked bread? We know some of the ladies here cook some really good fresh baked bread. I know it disappears really fast during a meal next door. But the word bread appears in the Bible 267 times, 184 in the Old Testament, 83 times in the New Testament. The first mention of bread is in Genesis chapter 14, verse 18. When Abraham was blessed by Melchizedek, it says, "Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine, which is the elements of communion. He was a priest of God Most High." Very key words right there. Melchizedek, whose name means king of righteousness. And Salem, which became, if I'm not mistaken, Jerusalem, means peace. It makes such a brief appearance in the Bibles, it is impossible to overlook its his importance. Not only because of the relationship he had with Abram, but more significantly because of the way both David in Psalms 110, verse 4, and the writer of Hebrews 7 views him as a type of Christ, the kingly priest. Another verse about bread or manna is in the desert, where the whole Israelite community, they grumbled against Moses and Aaron. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 4, it says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread from heaven for you, but the people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions." The Bible says in Matthew 3, verse 16 through Matthew 4, verse 4, it says, "As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. And at that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness." He didn't go on his own. He was led by the Spirit to be tempted by the devil. What was the first thing that the devil tempted him by? This says in verse 2, "After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to tempt him and said, If you are," which you can also say, "since you are, the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." And just like God's testing Abraham in Genesis 22, in which God asked that he give his only son, Isaac, the son whom he loved, as a sacrifice to Jehovah, in Abraham's act of obedience, he demonstrated the absolute commitment of his life to God and his will. Christ's commitment to the will of God is seen in his response. "It stands written," is what he said. Jesus' quote is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." It is from Israel's experience in the wilderness, when they were fed by the miraculous hand of God, but taught that the deeper meaning of life are more than to satisfy the hungers of the body. Such testing is a necessary part of life in revealing the true spirit of man. William Barclay quotes the Jewish saying, "The Holy One, blessed be his name, does not elevate a man to dignity until he has first tried and searched him. If he stands in temptation, then he raises him to dignity." Jesus had his sense of vocation tested with the choice between God's kingdom and Satan's. The next day after Jesus fed the 5,000, the crowd followed Jesus to Capernaum, and Jesus mentions that God has placed his seal of approval on him. John chapter 6, verse 26 through 35 says, Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I perform, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works that God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they ask him, silly question, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you?" They were just fed. Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." On the night Jesus was betrayed, in Matthew 26, verse 26 through 28, it says, "While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when they had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, 'Take and eat. this is my body. Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the righteousness, for the forgiveness of sins. Jumping over to John 13, verse 21-27, speaking about Judas here. After he said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified this. Very truly I tell you, one of you is going to betray me. His disciples stared at one another at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, disciples whom Jesus loved, that's John, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, ask him which one he means. They didn't know. They had doubts. Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. Then dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. So Jesus told him, what you are about to do, do quickly. After Jesus had taken his piece of bread, he made up his mind completely, and he surrendered his whole heart to Satan. Then Satan entered into Judas. The point to remember is that Satan accomplished total victory over Judas only because Judas allowed him to do so. We are one, never give place to the devil, Ephesians 4:27. We are also told to be encouraged. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you, James 4:7. Jesus served as a sacrificial lamb, and the night before his death, he provided the bread offering. We celebrate the bread as well as we recall the blood sacrifice of Jesus with communion when we share in the bread and in the wine. His death, the perfect sacrifice, replaced the animal sacrifice. The Apostle Paul stated that every time we share communion, we proclaim the death of Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians 11:26. That is a gift Jesus gave us. He died to free us from sin and death and to give us eternal life. We celebrate that and acknowledge Jesus is the bread of life. Bread is a wonderful analogy for Christ. The Lord Jesus is the one who looked at the waves on the Lake of Galilee and said, peace be still. And the wind and the waves obeyed him. How big are our waves? How unsettled is our heart? We come here, among other reasons, so that the Lord can say to us, peace be still. When he did this to the waves, the disciples' response was to ask who he was. What kind of man is this, saying peace, they ask. Christ is called the Prince of Peace because by his incarnation, his sacrifice, his mediation, he procures and establishes peace between God and man. He heals the breaches and dissensions between heaven and earth, reconciling both, and produces glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace and goodwill among men. His residence is peace and quietness and assurance forever in every believing upright heart. He governs as a prince and priest of the Most High God, ruling in righteousness, mighty to save, and he ever lives to make intercession for and save to the uttermost and all who come unto the Father by him. When we take communion as believers, we remember and celebrate what the bread and the cup symbolize, the free gift of God's grace and forgiveness. But maybe these days, we can also use some comfort as we navigate a world that is different from the first century, but which has just as much uncertainty. So today, let us remember that God has forgiven and redeemed us for eternity, and that he also deeply cares and loves us right now. May his presence and grace give us rest and comfort for today and hope for tomorrow as as we remember our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Special part of our service, dear Lord. We just pray, Father, that each and every one of us, dear Lord, can clear our minds of all earthly things, dear Lord. Examine ourselves, dear Lord, and remember the sacrifice that was made for each and every one of us, dear Lord. Dear Lord, as we meditate here, dear Lord, let us remember your body that was broken upon the cross, and what that meant for each and every one of us as we partake, in Jesus' name. Go ahead and prepare the cup. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, as I continue in prayer, Father, we're just so thankful, Father, for everything that you've done, and we just pray, Father, that we always give you the praise and the glory for it all. And dear Lord, we're just so thankful, Father, that you loved us enough that you sent your only begotten Son down here, Father, to suffer such a horrible death because of the love that you had for each and every one of us, dear Lord. Dear God, we know, Father, that you could took yourself off that cross at any time, but you loved us that you stayed there and took all the humiliation, the pain. You had the weight of sin on you, dear Lord. We just pray, Father, that we never forget your precious blood, dear Lord. And as we take this cup, let us remember your blood. If you would, we'll take a moment to examine ourselves and to remember.
Thank you, Paige, for the beautiful song, and well done. Thank you for the good devotion. Really appreciate it. And Clinton's opening prayer. We just appreciate all of you who contribute so much to our service. The theme of the message this morning is honor to whom honor. And certainly in our minds this morning, we have a lot of people that we want to honor because of what they did for us in defending our country. And we appreciate them, and we don't give them enough respect. And we, any chance we can get, should show them the honor that they deserve. Romans 13 and verse 7 gives us these words. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Certainly our veterans are precious to us, our fathers and brothers, husbands and wives who contributed so much to the safety of our country, and not only that, protecting the country, but helping to make possible the chance that we have the ability to worship according to the dictates of our hearts. So we certainly want to honor all of you today who have served. And at this time, if you have served our country, you please stand just for a moment. Please stand. If all of you stand, that I know there's something we got. Okay, got several here. Okay. Thank you. You may be seated. Christians are to be subject to authority. Our Heavenly Father ordained marriage. He ordained the church. And he ordained government. Many people, even who are Christians, think that even though God ordained government, that they can, on their own, defy the government, resist the government, do all they can to destroy the government. However, Christians are not to do that. Peter and Paul, in their writings, did not suggest that in the least. Peter and Paul both lived under very severe political situations when it came to the church. Now, the church may soon, sooner than later, have to suffer because of decrees of government. However, people like Peter and Paul had to suffer in their day with their lives. Paul was probably beheaded by the Emperor Nero, the Roman governor who blamed Christians for the calamities of his country. And yet, both of them wrote words in the scriptures at the dictates of God and the Holy Spirit to be subject to the authority. In Romans 13, verse 1, let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. Government is instituted by God, even as marriage was instituted by God and the church was instituted by God. Whenever God created an institution, he made arrangements for leadership of that institution. When he established the home, the father was appointed as the leader of it. When he instituted the church, the eldership were appointed as the leaders of the local church. When he appointed government, he talks about rulers and authorities and others who keep the peace, such as soldiers and policemen. So governments many times are not good. Sometimes we get very frustrated at our own governments, whether it be local or even national. And yet, we need to recognize that government itself is instituted by God. Just because God ordained an institution doesn't mean that those who are ahead of that local institution are right all the time. For example, in the church, Paul is constantly rebuking and reminding people against false teachers in the church and even leaders and rulers in the church who simply take control. So just because you have a particular institution instituted by God doesn't mean that those within the institution are always right. Just as in a home, the same is true. And in a country, the same is true. Some countries are ruled by pure despots who want nothing but their own selfish needs met. They think they are God, or they deny that there is a God. Yet God instituted government. It says in Romans 13, verses 2 and 3, consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. In spite of the fact that many rulers, leaders, politicians are bad, there are those who are good. They uphold the law. They are good policemen, many good policemen. There are good people who recognize that their job as government is to protect the good people and to punish the bad people. And so it is that God is saying this very thing here in scriptures like we have. In fact, God calls people who are in these positions as his servants, and in the King James translation, ministers. Look at Romans 13, verses 4 and 6. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoers. Now, because people forget about Scripture so much anymore in our society, they are forgetting about punishing evildoers, people in high places. But yet, that's what God wants done. That's the responsibility of government. Government should not interfere with the church. The church should not interfere with government. Government's job is to protect the righteous by punishing the wicked. The church's job is to help redeem the wicked and bring them to Christ. He says in verse 6, this is also why you pay taxes, for authorities are God's servants or ministers who give their full time to governing. So this puts it all in a different perspective. Even though we get frustrated with government and even angry with government, the thing is that this was all placed and put in effect so that there wouldn't be anarchy on the earth. In the book of Judges, the Bible says that everybody did that which was right in their own eyes. And you'll remember that there was havoc when you read those stories in the book of Judges. It was terrible what they were going through. And the people were being punished because they weren't paying any attention to God, His word, or even God's leaders. Because there has to be a standard for people to go by. Now, we admit that sometimes the ministers don't do their jobs. Ministers are leaders in church. Ministers of churches have abused churches, brought reproach upon churches because of their terrible lifestyle. But we know still that God's church is the agency in the world for redemption. And as we look at government, it's ordained so that we can follow the rules that are good rules, treating one another right, and of course the Bible always teaches that anyhow, respecting each other's rights. And if we do that, then there's going to be orderliness in the country in which we live. And the scriptures also tell us when this takes place, the word of God can spread faster. Then we see that we not only obey and respect the institution of government, but we do it for conscience' sake. In other words, we do it to be a good Christian. In Romans 13, look at verse number 5. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. When we respect God's laws, people will respect us. When we respect His laws for spiritual things and do those things, then people are going to honor God more. I was talking to a man this morning who was talking about his grandmother. He said her actions is what made him believe. And when people look at our actions, we don't have to even preach or say any scriptures. They know by our actions what we believe. Now, it's not that we don't need the word. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. But it's our actions who prove to people that there really is a God and a Christ and a Holy Spirit, and that we believe in them. We also noted here already, and I want to share some words from 1 Peter 2 before I quit. Government protects the good and punishes the evil. In 1 Peter chapter 2, look at verses 13 and 14. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. So you see, those who are wrong are to be punished. Those who are right are to be commended. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of evil people. Now, there have been situations in the early church, and you will recall them, in which the apostles were forbidden to preach. And they said they were going to anyhow. There are times when government conflicts with the Word of God. And if it does, we choose God's way. But if government does not conflict with the Word of God, then we obey the government. Because it's good for everybody when we do that. Peter said in verse 16, I'll close with this verse. Live as free people. It takes me back to the very first point I made. Honor to whom honor is due. Because of what they did, the service that they rendered to our country, and are still doing so, we live as a free people. But we know that there's freedom from bondage of government, but there's also freedom from bondage of sin. In 1 Peter 2 and verse 16, we have these words, live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. Some people use their freedom to harm others. But you see, our freedom ends when another person's rights are being violated. So let's live as free people. We know that Jesus has made us free. Free from sin. And because we're free from sin, we will have better homes. We'll have better churches. And we'll have better government. Because of that freedom that Jesus has given to us. So let's take to heart these words, even though we may not want to listen to them, especially when we get angry at the way some leaders act. Let's remember that it is God ordained, government is. And because of it, we can have peace and stability. And when there's peace and stability, then the church can grow as well. But of course, we want that peace and stability in our lives first. It begins with us. And we know, and according to the Sunday school lesson that we had today, that Saul of Tarsus was making havoc of the church. He was causing all kinds of confusion. He was harming people physically. He was doing all he could to destroy the church. And when he changed, he was doing all he could to build up the church. So when one person changes, the home can change. The government can change. The church can change. So if you're that one person or more, whatever your need is today, who would like to change their lives for the best, remember that our Lord, through his truth, has set us free. So at this time, we'll sing our invitation. Let's stand together and use 639 verses 1 and 4.